unsupervised learning. So supervised learning involves the knowledge of the correct results by the machine. That means what we can predict that has to be learned before. And it has the ability to map the input data to the output data. That means we have to collect the input data to go forward to the output data. But in the unsupervised learning, which is typically complex, there is no knowledge of the correct output data is provided, or maybe in some cases there are some data are known. So another thing is important things, that is the artificial neural networks. And it is the model on the neural networks in the brain. And this is basically a basic block diagram of an artificial neural networks. And the main of the block is the neuron. And the neuron takes many input signals and performs a calculation to give an output as a signal. So we have a current belief that if there is a larger number of data which is independent variable, that is rarely linearly separable, and it is more complex implementation involving many interconnected neurons, and which is called the multi-layer networks. And there are three parts of the multi-layer networks. That is the input, another is the hidden, another is the output. So artificial neural networks is based upon a map weighting, and this does not have any relevance to the real data. So it has the prediction. So this makes the understanding of the network, which is very difficult. So now another important term is the genetic algorithm. So genetic algorithm is a class of search algorithms that try to find some maximal or minimal value in the different search place. It means in the machine learning space, there is a search space. And in the search space, we can find the maximal or minimal values. And there is a pool of random candidate solutions are generated to create an initial population of chromosomes. Each chromosome is an encoded bit representation, which may or may not have an optional solution to the problem. And thus, this problem is called the fitness function. This process is necessary to iterate through many generations, trying to different generations of the initial population. So chromosomes which have higher fitness value have the greater probability of being selected to move on the next generation. And this algorithm is typically stopped when the subsequent generations fail to present improvement of previous generations. So if the previous improvement of the previous generation fail, the next algorithm is stopped. And it is typically suited for the resource or maintenance that is called the schedule optimization. So now, what is data? This is very important term in machine learning. So data develops a model based on the provided data. The quality of the data is very important because there are some issues regarding the redundant data, inconsistency, missing values, or extreme or outlier values. And of course, the size of the data sets will have also the significant effect on the resulting model, because there is a current belief if the data is larger, so there is a probability of produce the better modeling. And this has led to the use of the important term that is called big data. So there are two types of data sets actually. One is the training data set, another is the testing data set. And the training data set is used to feed the models, while the test set is used for assessment of the generalized error of the final chosen model. And the testing data set is the test set which is independent of the training set and which is only shown to the model to assess the error. So now we will learn the big data. So big data is a term utilized to refer to the increase in the volume of the data that are difficult to store process or analyze through the conventional database technologies. So another definition of the big data is a set of techniques and technologies that may require new forms of integration to uncover the hidden values from larger data sets that are diverse, complex, and of a massive scale. And big data is characterized by the four V's. The first V is the volume, which is amount of data generated. And second is the variety. And the data could be collected as a text or as an audio. It could be either in structured or unstructured form. And the third is the velocity, which relates to the transfer rate to capture the data. So if the velocity is more higher, that means the ability, the capturing of the data should be higher. And the last V is the value. It is the process of discovering value from the larger data sets. That means it is the resulting information. So if we look at the right side of the image, we could see about the diagnosis. It means this is the primary step of a patient by implementing the machine learning. That means the generation of the data or the collection of the data is very small. So one after each steps, that is the treatment planning, treatment delivery, follow-up. So one after another, the gathering of the data is getting higher. So volume is getting larger. So another very important term, that is the deep learning. It allows the computational models that are composed of multiple processing layers to learn representation of data with multiple levels of abstraction. And its architectures include deep neural networks, deep belief networks, and convolution neural networks. The particular characteristics of these deep networks is the inclusion of many hidden layers that are able to learn feature directly from the data. So for neural networks, the learning takes place by first going through the training set and evaluating an error rate. And then it's multiplied by a learning rate. And finally, the product is applied back into the weights of the network to reduce the error rate, which is called back propagation. So after the back propagation is then repeated and a new error rate is calculated. However, the back propagation is monotonic as the calculation is a determination of error is gradient. When the error rate is sufficiently small, the network is considered to have converged. So another term is the vulnerability. So machine learning techniques are vulnerable to what is known as overfitting. And this makes the model learn patterns which are highly specific to the training set provided. And it has the prediction from the known data, which is very good, but fails to generalize desirably over the new data. Another vulnerability, which is known as adversarial images, which exists for deep neural networks. And it is possible to carefully choose images that appear normal to humans, but sense the output of the network. So, application of artificial intelligence and machine learning radiation oncology. This is a basic flowchart of the radiation therapy treatment, which start with the patient assessment and ends with the patient follow-up. In between, there is simulation, treatment planning, quality assurance, and treatment delivery. So now we will look how artificial intelligence and machine learning can be applied in radiation oncology. So artificial intelligence and machine learning applications in medicine represent an emerging field of research with the potential to revolutionize the field of radiation oncology. In the radiation oncology research, it is going very fast with the applications of such kind of state-of-the-art technologies, so-called artificial intelligence and machine learning. and which includes the patient diagnosis and staging of cancer, treatment simulation, treatment planning, quality assurance of treatment delivery, and finally, the treatment response and outcome predictions. So first, the patient diagnosis and staging of cancer. So we can diagnose the patient and staging of the cancer by three ways. The first one is the computer-aided detection. So detection can be made by a physician or radiologist, and he or she must take into account the computer as a second opinion. So model-based, machine learning-based models helps the detection of the tumor. For example, lung nodules in the CT images using the artificial neural networks. We can also assess the microcalcification brain masses in mammography image with the convolution neural network. And we also have assessed the prostate and brain lesion in MRI image using deep learning. And computer-aided detection lead to avoid missing cancer regions. That means there is some microscopic disease which can be avoided by this technique. And it also increase the sensitivity and specific detection. And of course, it diminishes inter and intra-observer variability. Because there are, if there is four oncologists and they have the same patient and they are counting the same breast case, but there is, of course, there is some variation in terms of target as well as in the OR. So there has been the data shown a tumor has been contoured by 25 physicians. There is the standard deviation of more than 2%. This is really huge. So this can be avoided by the implemented of the computer-aided detection. The second one is the computer-aided diagnosis. And the computer-aided diagnosis focuses on the distinction and automatically classifying a tumor or lesion which is being malignant or benign with the possibility of providing the likelihood of diagnosis. If we look at the image, the above two images is from the ultrasound imaging, which is for breast lesion, and the below two images, which is from CT images for lung nodules. This is very difficult for a medical student or non-trained doctor to get the lesion properly. That is why computer-aided diagnosis helps to understand where is the lesion is involved. It reduces the misdiagnosis rate for malignant cases and also decrease the false positive. So what is false positive? So something is that there is a benign or malignant tumor, but ultimately there is no malignancies. That is called false positive, and that can be happened for surgical biopsy. We have seen, based on our experiments, we have seen there are a lot of issues. In one lab, there is the malignant is positive, and another lab, there is the malignant is negative. So this can be avoided by the implementation of computer-aided diagnosis. So the last term for the patient diagnosis of stage cancer is the assessment and consultation. So when we assess or consult with the patients, we need to have very useful information like the tumor growth, tumor stasis, or there is the maximal proximity of the maximal distance of the tumor and the where. Also, we have to consider the patient ability to where the patient is able to take the load of the motion management, or the some other issues. Also, we have to need to consider patient age or also the type of the disease. So this kind of information we have to provide during the assessment and consultation. But there are some missing things. For example, there is some information also we need to provide if there is a patient with a cardiac device, or if the patient who are pregnant. So those information we could provide in the system, the system can automatically take into the account all those information, and based on that the computer gives us a best decision to the oncologist as well as the patient, which is comfortable both the clinicians and for the patient also. The machine learning models, it has the sixth term, that is called the logistic regression, decision trees, random forest, gradient boosting, and the service vector machine. So these all the terms work for assess a patient based on the information provided into the system and provided the best decision. So next, how we could implement the artificial intelligence intelligent simulation. For example, for the 3D and 4D CT image acquisition, we have to provide all the many information. During the preparation of a patient, that includes the fiducial placement, we have to think about the bladder rectum filling. We have to consider of the kidney function of the patient, if the patient needs the intravenous contrast. We have to give the special instruction for the patient with cardiac device or the patient who are pregnant, because the CT simulation is a critical time and it helps to achieve an accurate, high quality, robust and deliverable plan. If there is a wrong CT simulation, the patient has to go for the repeated simulation. That is also harmful to the patient, because there are 40% radiation induced cancer that is are being diagnosed based on the diagnostic excess radiation from the diagnostic radiology. We have to consider the 4D CT scanning, and this is used increasingly to track the tumor motion in relation to the respiratory of the cycle of the patient, and this is really necessary for successful implementation of the estrogenic body radiation therapy. And machine learning model could have an essential role to play in this situation to improve the simulation quality. There are four machine learning methods have been proposed so far for the treatment simulation. The first one is the global respiratory motion model, and it is relating to the external patient surface motion to the internal structure motion, and which does not require any 4D CT. The second was the correlation and linear regression, which quantify of the 4D CT or 4D cone beam CT based on the axial motion range during the treatment using Calypso. And Calypso is a device for extracranial SBRT from Varian Medical System. The next one is the artificial neural network model, and which helps to track the liver tumors through lung diagram border without having any fiducial markers. Or sometimes we need to change the fiducial markers from one place to another place if we could calculate the lung diaphragm border, because lung, during the motion, lung and diaphragm come very closer. Another is the principal components analysis model, which is reconstructing the breathing composite images, and which shows the phases of gastrointestinal motion. So now again the treatment simulation, and first one we have seen the image acquisition, and now we will see the image reconstruction. And here the application of machine learning is huge. So machine learning method is very, very, very powerful to reconstruct image from one modality to another modality. Here is the two important applications. One application is CT from the MRI image. If we see the left side image, the top left is the MRI image. And from this MRI image, the image construction model by the machine learning method can be performed a estimated CT image. because sometimes we cannot make the plan with the MRI image because we need the electron density which does not have the MRI image. But alternatively, we also have the problem with the CT image because CT image have the poor image quality for the soft tissue, and the top right image is the ground truth, which is from the MRI image. So another application is the we can produce one higher image from the lower quality image. So if we see the right side image, the upper 3 image, the upper 3 image from the 3 Tesla MRI, and the below 3 image is like the
Mr. Akhtar, we have time limitation. Please finish your lecture within 2 or 3 minutes.
Okay. So the below 3 images is reconstructed from the 3 Tesla MRI image, but it shows like that this is look like the 7 Tesla MRI image. This is very this is more clear than the 3 Tesla MRI. So another application is the image registration or fusion. So various machine learning method based for image registration have proposed by investors are not only for align the anatomical structure but also elevated the appearance difference. So there are 5 different image registration procedure. One is the regression forest for image registration for 2 arbitrary image MR image. Next one, the similarity function for comparing image spaces, which is called the computer vision problem. Next one is the discriminative local derivative method. This is very fast and robust registration. Another one, the deep neural network. This is automated quantification of deformal image radiation performance. And the next one is the deep unsupervised learning strategy, and which is related to the convolution CT deformal image registration. And all methods have revealed superior performance regarding accuracy in multimodal image registration. So another, this is very important, image segmentation or auto contouring. The segmentation or the auto contouring process has subsequently become popular via automated or semi-automated analytical model-based software, which is commercially available for clinical use. It's called the Atlas-based models. And these software tools are performing reasonably well for critical organs or wires for delineation, but not yet ready for tumor or the target volume. So instead of the art, machine learning algorithms may play an effective role here for both drugs. That means for target as well as for the normal tissues. So several machine learning methods have reported for tumor or target delineation, segmentation for brain, prostate, rectum, or sclerosis lesions. So target segmentation using machine learning method base is still remaining a challenging task for some reasons, such as because of the availability of the big data, unavailability of the big data of multimodal image. So deep learning particularly well suited for segmentation, and it has shown superiority over the other machine learning algorithms for tumor and organ segmentation tasks. If we see the right side image, and the column A is the normal image, and column B is the manual contouring by a physician, and column C is the predicted and predicted image by using the machine learning methods, and the column D is a comparison between the manual and the predicted, and it is almost same. There is no difference between the predicted and the manual auto contouring. So now we have to move to the treatment planning. The application of machine learning in radiotherapy treatment planning as a tool for knowledge-based treatment planning, as well as the which is called data-driven, and another one is the automated or self-driving. So let's see what is knowledge-based treatment planning or data-driven treatment planning. So knowledge-based treatment planning, the approach is
Mr. Akhtar, within 1 or 2 minutes, please.
And time is spent on generating a new treatment plan from each incoming patient as well as its potential to decision making support in radiotherapy. The current commercial products for knowledge based treatment planning are limited to predict the DVS, that means the dose constants within the acceptance range. So a more recent commercial product like the quick mass or the registration use gradient boosting to explore prediction in dosimetric trade-offs. In the next class, we will see a figure regarding this. And these applications provide quick rapid predicted treatment planning results to be obtained before the treatment planning process. So thus it can facilitate communication between physicists and physicians, establish individualized and achievable goals, and help physician and patient decide the course of a plan before initializing the treatment planning process. And this approach has also been applied to post-planning quality assurance of DVS data. Ultimately, data-driven planning is not fully automated. As I said before, it has some limitation. At present, it requires expert oversight and or intervention to ensure safely deliverable treatment plans. So next, we will see the automated planning. Once the dosimetric goals have been established, the treatment technique chosen, automated plan generation is also possible. Some attempts have made to solve various aspects of this problem by predicting the best beam consideration, and at the same time, we can make the multiple plans to have a comparison to have the best plan. The larger tracks of automated treatment planning, however, it is well suited for reinforcement learning method and algorithm learns, which is the algorithm learns to navigate a set of rules given some constraints by self-correcting its decision. Basically, the algorithm will take a decision, for instance, increase the weight of a given constant, and learn from the simulator, which is a treatment planning system, whether the decision resulted in the right direction. If there is not in the right direction, then we may change. Overall, one challenge for achieving full automated planning using reinforcement learning lies in the close integration of need for robust treatment planning system. That means we need the very fast transmission system. The future vision is toward a fully automated planning process from contouring to plan creation with human experts. Of course, otherwise the human expert will be, there will be less implementation of human expert. That means we will be the data scientists called dosimetry physicians and physicians evaluating, supervising, and providing quality assurance to the given results. There is, if you see the above figure, this is the conventional planning technique. It means we need the image, contouring, beams, optimization, dose. But for the automated planning, we need only the image and the contouring. And the dose, beams, and mimic, this is automatically, it will be automatically done by the automated planner. That means the automatic planning systems. Now we have to go through the quality assurance and treatment planning. So in the quality assurance, the machine learning has the potential in many aspects of radiotherapy quality assurance program, especially in error detection and prevention, machine QA and patient specific QA, etc. Machine learning may contribute to automating the quality assurance procedure and analysis, which is increase the efficiency and decrease the physical efforts of the physicist or dosimetrist. And for machine learning methods, quality assurance process can be categorized as the machine-based QA approach and the patient-specific based QA approach. So for machine-based QA approach is the application of
please finish as quick as possible.
The performance of continuous improvement of the patient's therapy. The next one is the utilization anomaly detection to overcome the problem of direct modeling of QA errors and the rare events. And finally, the quantifying the error detection effectiveness of commonly used quality assurance parameters. So here is the patient-based QA approach. So use of the segment vector machine-based system to automatically detect problems with the linear 2D or 3D imaging system, especially for the image-guided radiotherapy treatment accuracy.
Go to the conclusion. We have only 1 or 2 minutes.
Individualized IMRT QA passing rates. So neural network and the QBIST algorithm used to predict machine MLC positional errors for IMRT and VMAT plans. The inclusion of this predicted deviation is leaves positioning into the TPS during the dose calculation lead to a more realistic representation of plan delivery. So machine learning involvement in QA purpose carry implicit maintenance cost in the form of additional QA demands for the algorithm themselves. If you see the figure, now there is some machine learning methods which are implemented in the QA process, and the latter few is the MLC position. One is the actual position, and the below is the actual position that is predicted by the machine learning method. So quality assurance treatment delivery. So implementation of
adaptive Mr. Akhtaruzzaman, please go to the conclusion, and we have to finish within.
Into routine clinical practice is technically challenging. I need more than 5 minutes maybe, and request significant resources to perform and validate these process steps, because adaptive
delivery. You know the Zoom. We have only time limitation. Time limitation. Please finish.
So adaptive radiotherapy by implementation with the machine learning is very useful to perform a adaptive radiotherapy plan. So now it is the patient flow up. We have to categorize in the treatment outcome as well as the radiomics for precision medicine. Also can follow up the patient by using the machine learning methods. So now the discussion. So big data in radiology, is there any challenge? So how many minutes I have? How many minutes I have?
Hello. Finish. Already finished. We have to go to the conclusion and close it.
Just give me 1 minute. So there are some discussions. Is there big data generation challenge? Yes, there is some, of course, challenge, because there is some unavailability of the big
go to
data.
The conclusion. Go to the conclusion.
Imaging system. So there is some standardized guideline which has been provided in the AAPM Tracks Group 263. So is there any strength and limitation of the machine learning algorithms applied? Yes, there is some, of course, there is some strengths and also there is some limitations. So, a major limitation is it's called the black box stigma, where the machine learning algorithm maps a given input data to output without providing any additional insight into the system. That is why we also, though we have the machine learning, we also need the manpower or the physicians to get inside of the systems. So how far the reported results by the investigator correct? Yes, the study shows there are 89.96 results are correct. And how would the reported results are improved? Yes, constantly working as we want to improve the reported results. And it also impact on the clinical, automatic clinical process. So it also, as I said before, it also have the impact on the support to precision medicine in radiation oncology. Finally, the discussion. From patient consult to follow up, with the era of the big data, the utilization of machine learning is growing fast. The machine learning techniques could compensate for human limitations in handling a large amount of following information in the efficient manner, in which simple errors can be make the difference between the life and death. Machine learning is also indispensable in the radiomics scheme, characterization of immune phenotypes with the potential of decision making and precision radiation therapy, predicting treatment outcomes for individual patients rather than one size fits all approach. Thank you very much. Thank you for your kind attention.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Akhtar, for your nice presentation. But we have very, very time limitation. You know that in Zoom, only we have free meeting only 40 minutes, whatever. So now, a very, very one or two questions we can give you answer. We can take some question. One question from Masud Rana. Any radiotherapy center should start their facility with the AI technology in beginning? What is your opinion?
Well, before implementing any sophisticated or state-of-the-art techniques or tools in the clinical setup, we must be trained. We must be understand what is the, how the system is working on, and if there is any problem, there is a massive disaster in the clinical setups. So before implementing any device, we must be careful. But of course, we have to go through with the recent trends, and that is my opinion. We must go with the recent trends, otherwise we will be behind 100 kilometers back of the world.
Okay, thank you. So another question from Mirza Ghalib. You already, maybe you have already described in your presentation how to work artificial intelligence in medical oncology field.
Sorry, can you repeat it?
How work artificial intelligence in medical field?
In
medical oncology field.
How it work?
How it works, but who is work?
Yeah.
Artificial intelligence.
Artificial, man, what is the working procedure of artificial intelligence in medical field, oncology
already,
department?
Already shown his presentation.
Okay.
So
as I described before, as I described from the beginning, so artificial intelligence it consists of the machine learning, deep learning, artificial neural networks. So artificial does not work alone in the system. So it is a combination of the work. So first we have to model the system. The planning system does not know what is artificial intelligence and what is. Work, we have to model that. So without having a model, it cannot work because it does not have any thinking power. We have to give them a clue.
Okay. So
you should work like that. Then it will work. Otherwise, it won't work.
Okay. So maybe due to time limitation, I don't take any other questions. So at the end, I again congratulate Mr. IMP President Madhur Rihani sir. And also APOM President Dr. Arun Chokle for greeting us and wishes. Thanks again from Bangladesh Medical Physics Society. So at the end, I want to put some comment, Professor Dr. Arunupama Azhari. Can you hear me?
Yes, are you hearing?
Yeah.
Thank you, Bangladesh Medical Physics Society, for taking this nice initiation.
Can you unmute all other participants except Dr. Rupama?
For the first time for webinar program in this COVID-19, and all the physicists has tried to join, and as you know that many of the students and many physicists are who are in out of network in our country situations, so many of us cannot join, but these topics are very now the our demands topics. And then the lecturers are very outspoken, and they know they are everything very clearly. And I think participants joins enjoy it. And I hope that you will continue this webinar program, not only in this COVID-19, but you should make a schedule so that others, executive members and other medical physicists can also speak further, and they can make known people to your knowledge and your capability. Thank you all.
Thank you, Secretary General of APOM, Professor Dr. Hazin Unupama Azhari. Now I want to say Professor Ghulam Abu Zakaria, the conclusion of this session, because this is the last day of our webinar. Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much for the nice presentation. Just Professor Azhari told, all the speakers are very good. Sometimes you have trouble in the communication media. This is not your fault, but you have tried very well and it is very organized. I thank everybody here. Please continue this one, and you have done a great job for it. The BMPS is a new society, and you have done a challenging things, and I'm very happy and congratulate you once again. Thank you once again.
Thank you very much, sir. From BMPS Medical Physics Society, we said we will continue in future this type of webinar. I already talked with Sir Masood and Mr. James also. Most of us, they are very, very agreed to continue with people. So I'm unmute all your video and other things. So you can open your video. All the requests to open your video. So can I get the picture? Request to open your video. We want to take a picture, some picture. Okay, thank you once again. To participate in this conference, and this is our conclusion. So thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Unmute the microphone.